Actually, Inudo, what they are looking, because as the Inudo, they are working with the industrial sectors, with the ministry. And earlier, one project they handle, even UNDP is also involved in the concentrated solar thermal projects. What is the learning? Because as you know, the ministry in the 2012, they installed near about 20,000 square meter. And after 2012 till date, they execute more than 60,000 square meters. And the trend is because they are earlier, they're using for the cooking application for the steam generations. But right now the industries, they are looking for the performance. And of course the quality is very important, not even the cost, the quality. Because as you know, the industries like Bosch, SKF, Mahindra, they have a very strong technical teams. And after that, you just see the figures for the last 5 years, more than 20,000 square meter they installed in the industries. Of course, the quality is very important to sustain the technology, sustain the sustainability of the project. And one more important thing is the operation maintenance. Because earlier, they don't have any operation maintenance. They don't have understand the technology, how they perform better. They don't have any online performance monitoring. Right now in the ministry, they are going for the online performance monitoring, which is supported by the UNDP INEDO. So still there is a scope. Of course, the performance is very important to see the quality and convince to the industries. This is my feedback, which is involved in the earlier project of the concentrated solar thermals.
Thank you, sir. So with that, we'll open the floor to questions. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can have this one.
Good afternoon. My name is Piyush Bhateja, and I'm from Starcraft BLP Solar Solutions. My question to the panel is that today we across the country, we are doing probably 1,000 to 2,000 roofs of solar rooftop projects in a year. But maybe 2 to 3 years down the line, even the solar rooftop tariffs might fall to maybe 4 rupees a unit or even 3.5 rupees a unit. And the industrial tariffs, the tariff for the industries from DISCOMs might be at 8 rupees all across the country. And at that time, the price differential in itself will be so huge that will be a no-brainer to go for solarization. In that kind of a scenario, we might be looking at doing maybe 20,000 roofs a year all across the country. So as an industry, what can be the potential challenges from the project development side, the project execution side, and even the O&M side, when we'll be dealing with such a large number of projects running all across the country all the time, and how we can mitigate that, obviously?
So I think we are a little short on EPCs on this panel, but I'll go with the EPC that we do have. Not to nothing again, it's great EPC, and please, you'll have to answer. No one to counter your points, though.
So I think if you look at, like, right now, when you say, I don't know how many roofs we're doing, do you guys think we're doing 1,000 roofs?
Sounds about right. Maybe
little less than that, probably, right? So one major shift that is going to happen that I see in going from 1,000 to 20,000 is that the residential market would have picked up. Okay, right now the kind of talent structuring in the companies, especially EPCs, which we do, is based on that, you know, one project that we get, it's going to be 100, 200, 250 kilowatt at least, right? We don't do less than, let's try not do less than 200, 250 kilowatt. At that point of time, doing 2 kilowatt, 3 kilowatt, 4 kilowatt, 5 kilowatt is going to need different kind of companies, right? And as we have seen in this industrial boom also, right, a lot of local players had emerged, right, are there. It's fair to say that it is a highly localized industry, right, solar today. Even when system sizes are 100, 200 kilowatt, I think Tata is the only player which is actually present in more than 20 states, right? 15 states, let's say, not even 20. That point of time, I think it's going to be more local players that are going to, you know, crop up. And either it's going to be like a Tata taking up all of this. They have the kind of money, the kind of backing. They can burn that much to build up that this thing. But that kind of an industry will then make money on AMC and not on the actual installation. On the actual installation, they might be losing money. So that's what I feel.
I have one more point. I think the moment
the solar starts giving 30% to 40% of the renewable energy mix, the grid will destabilize. Yeah, so I mean, I think we would really move ahead. I think as Ritu had also mentioned, we would move to off-grid or what you call with battery backup storage technologies a lot more, actually. So the going forward, the industry will move from grid connected to being more battery backup, grid storage based, because the grid will not allow you. Today also the government understands this issue very well. The reason why they have promoting grid connected is because they have to give an incentive on which they have a budget. So their budget will increase if you start putting a battery backup based systems. That is the only reason. Otherwise, technically, if you look at in markets in US and Germany, all those are driven by lithium ion, lithium ferrous. I mean, Abhi Intersolar is next week. Ek hall panels ka hai, do hall is off-grid and battery storage technologies. That is how it is going to happen. So that is where I see.
Before we go on, Ritu, if I may ask you, because you have scaled and you have done many projects at the same time, very different number 2 years ago versus now. So maybe some thoughts would be valuable.
See, the number of people we had on board, again, one thing about our organization is we have end-to-end in-house processes, so we don't really outsource. The only thing that we outsource is the actual installation and commissioning contract workforce. That's about it. The rest of it is all in-house. We've scaled up. Now, so if we were like 30, 40 people in like 2015, today we are 150 plus. But we can't just keep adding full-time people. So now we are working to add contracted agencies or people who work for us, but you know how they're structured, because you know we can't just be mushrooming. But we've not really got there yet. As of now, we are still stretched for resources. You know, we moved to our office in July of last year, and before which we moved to another office. So we started, as I was like employee number 5 when we came in, we were working out of a business center, and one guy moved his desk left and one right, and I snuck a chair in between, and we shared that desk for a few months. So then we moved into a place where it looked like I had a massive desk to myself. Became too small. Then when we moved in here July last year, my boss said this can seat 100 whatever people. We are here for a long time. It's not even been a year. We've run out of space. We're hiring more on the floor above. But we can't keep doing that. We'll have to find other models. Otherwise, if there is an opportunity, this is India we're talking about. If there's an opportunity for 20,000 installations a day, entrepreneurs will crop up. Again, at all levels of the spectrum, from top-notch international world standard quality to absolute rubbish, which is there in any segment in, you know, in probably all over the world, not just India. Different rules, you know, the bankers are here, how retail banking works versus how high net, you know, HNI works versus how your corporate banking works. There are solutions for everything, and I don't know about the pricing being 3 rupees, but other than that, I don't have any fear. The one thing that you'll need to look at is O&M, because this all of these projections assume that your solar plant will be working optimally for its entire commercial life. And I find the service element in this whole thing a bit lacking today. So if we can all fall flat on our faces within the next 3 years and do the industry a lot of disservice, if we are not scaling there. And all of us, I think, everybody on the panel, are we very honestly speaking, and I'm absolutely there on the O&M, we are not. We're playing a lot of catch up.
Yeah, I mean, very quickly, our response. So yeah, on literally the last point first, we literally started with we being very heavy on O&M. We knew that, so that is literally how we started. The gentleman who built that whole team is here. Then. Every year, we train a very large number of EPCs installers in our particular ways. So we are free training, doing Seki's job, Usa's job. I'm not sure, Mr. Shekhar Dutt would tell us whose all job we are doing, but training people in how to install correct solar, how to follow IEC standards, et cetera, et cetera. Again, you can speak further with Andre to learn more about it. That's us. That's how we are expanding the ability to do 50 projects like a quarter as opposed to 20.
Okay, you know, India has a unique problem, is that is the last mile is the most difficult to conquer.
Correct.
And I think all of you all realize the last mile is going to be done by people who are doing INC. Now, for some strange reason, the costs are coming down in solar, but the people that are at the last leg at the INC is the segment that is getting squeezed the most. Now, somebody talked about punch points. So having struggled with this INC business now for the last 1 year, see, there's a clear case of training of workforce. There's a clear case for automation. There's a clear case for us to get the entire workforce properly organized, trained into some kind of a formal sector. But in India, for some strange reason, we talk a lot in seminars, but the guy who's actually doing the implementation is working worse than an animal. The rooftop segment, he's working in a 55 degree centigrade temperature. And believe you me, I'm coming from a site, you can't be there for more than half an hour. You're going to collapse. Now, what I'd request all of you all, and I'm meaning from the bottom of my heart, is that please consider the fact that the INC player is the same guy who's going to be doing your O&M after some time. So that segment needs to automate. It needs all the technology as much as the top end requires. So what you all need not do and what should be understood is that there's no justification why the INC costs have dropped so far. And because of this drop and because of squeezing margins in INC, we can't invest in automation, which would really change things drastically. We cannot invest in getting better workforce because we have to rely only on the minimum wage workforce, which is the most basic. And given the conditions, the normal guys who could get a better job don't want to come and do the INC work, which is most critical. So unlike Europe or Germany, where you have proper, you know, the guy who's a technician is being trained to do that job, so he's perfect. If he does it once, it doesn't have to be done again. So all of you all are going to be facing huge implementation problems and cost overruns because the fact is that the lowest part of the segment has not been focused on. Everybody wants to sit in plush offices, but solar is a dirty business. You know, like in solar, you have to get yourself tanned. Only then you understand what the damn business is all about. So what I'm suggesting also, and I will request all of you all, is that please spend more time with the INC vendors and try and figure out how they can improve their business model. Because if they become viable, all your O&M and your long-term issues, a lot of them will get taken care of. Today, the INC guys are literally moving from project to project. And there are a lot of companies that will hire one INC team for one project, and the next one, they'll have a new team. So they're kind of starting off from scratch again.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, you know, only in the interest of time, each one of your comments is, so first of all, I didn't get to look all the way, but I know that Ritu and I were nodding the whole time that you were actually talking. Every point that you made is absolutely, from our perspective, completely accurate. We are completely aware of that. There were many comments earlier today, or maybe it was yesterday, about like how like human resources is one of India's strengths. Last mile installer and the trades, as they are called, I would say, is a huge weakness. They're one of the weakest. I mean, they're completely untrained, ill-trained, or poorly trained, or worse. So that's our perspective. You know, your answer to your thing lies with gentlemen like them and how they get trained. Unfortunately, Mr. Shekhar, that just left, because that's a person who's been trying to focus on training not hundreds but like tens of thousands of people in solar installation. It's a job creating area to learn how to tighten a screw. Somebody was talking about a torquing issue earlier. Right, so I don't know if the gentleman, another question, Anand, 5 minutes maybe? Anand, five, okay, thanks. Sir, actually, just give me 1 minute. Did anyone else have comments on this? Yeah. Say so just a little louder, it seems not to be working. Okay, I'll repeat it. Please go ahead.
Sorry, yeah. Since everybody knows the conventional fuels are depleting, so are these solar powered cars the call of the future? Is it in the purview of the rooftop developers? How effective are they, and will the electric cars, the proposal for electric cars, pose the biggest challenge? Thank you.
I will go to the innovator amongst us on this one, who's quietly, you know, not said much on this. Please, maybe if you have some perspective, and any of the other panelists thereafter.
So, electric vehicles is definitely a thing that's going to be a reality very soon. I think Minister Piyush Goyal already announced that the government vehicles will soon be converted into electric vehicles. Mass transportation and charging infrastructure is one of the areas in electric vehicles that's going to happen very soon. We are working on that. We are aiming at launching the pilots end of this year across states on mass transportation solutions under OPEX model, which is what we are doing on solar on the RESCO side. And there will be financing around that. And I think day before there was already an article that the gasoline-based vehicles will be phased out by 2022. If that's not reality, maybe by 2025, but that's going to happen. More so from the perspective of emissions, especially in urban markets, and the pollution control, which anyways under the smart city concept and the lower or the environmental aspect, government will push for it. And US and European markets are already into it. So you'll see that. And I think that's the next business area to go.
Okay. Yeah, one quick comment before we let that one go. So, sir, if you could please obviously look at Elon Musk's business model, the three legs, solar cars with batteries, which automatically act as storage, electric cars with batteries and solar panels in parking lots. That's definitely something to read up.
Yes, yeah, sir. This is Vasubra, madam. I saw you gasping for breath and frustrated when you talked about SECI and then all that. So maybe you take it as an unsolicited advice. Don't tread that path, you won't succeed.
Well,
I'll give you an example. Two examples I'll give you. We used to be part of this extensive lobbying team, initial solar days. And one state was missing out of the JNNSM initial policy heavily. So I used to be part of that state team. So I went to the CM and CM spoke to PM. PM spoke to Renewable Minister. I don't know how many of you are there. And the first JNSM got delayed by 6 months, 3 to 6 months. We were the cause for that. MNRE didn't do anything at the end of the day. Don't happen.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, word
and
of
second
caution,
thing,
but,
second
but,
thing,
but
no,
given,
no.
The, given her enthusiasm, we are not sure this is not going to move.
No, I just don't want to feel frustrated at the end of the day. She can concentrate on Gautam Solar and get more business, compete with you more. Okay.
Yes, then
the other... Other one is that you wanted to bring together the developers or whoever it may be, all of you. And I used to go to every state and then we used to represent those time. I think 15 was very low tariff. 18 used to be very low tariff. They narrowed down on 18. And we used to fight all 10 of us in the room. So a little later, the same, the other side government will call me and said, here is the Mantha, the man who fought with you has given the lowest tariff bill. So don't worry.
Last question. Anybody on that side? Okay. All right. Please go ahead, Mr. Mittal.
Yeah. So, what has been the experience with the payments with these corporates? You're getting it on a monthly basis, and when you're selling power.
The experience with corporates on payments,
yeah,
right?
On the monthly payments of
yes.
Power.
So I'll go
directly is reflected with the payments which we have to go to the bank. I mean,
yeah,
bank.
No, excellent question, and I'm surprised it came up so late. But this is not the panel for the reason is maybe it's not the panel for it. But we deal with them the most, right? I mean, we are actually selling a corporate product every month. You have to collect. Fantastic question. I'll just pick up on Mr. Kumar's point earlier. SME experience is very different from MNC experience. And the rest I'll let you answer.
No comments.
See, just because we haven't had an issue so far doesn't mean it's not going to crop up. And obviously one hopes it does not and that we can resolve it. Because enforcing a contract, and we have, and I'd like to probably, I don't know if you've seen any of AmPlus contracts, the PPAs are very, very stringent. With all that, I don't think we ever want to come to a situation where we're saying, okay, let's take it to court. This is the contract you signed with us, and you're not paying us. So we try and weed things out right at the beginning. We try and funnel, clients through a very rigorous credit process. This is not only their credit rating, and I've said this before, this is also their credit behavior. Because I find very strong, and this I find more with the Indian large conglomerates, where it's not a question of credit rating, it's their credit behavior, where suppliers are kept waiting for payments and, you know, we can't afford to wait 90 days for our payments. So it's not happened yet, but who knows? So.
The PPA is being renegotiated because of the lower tariffs that come in every 6 months. So yeah. So that's a big risk. How do you mitigate those risks?
See, when we talk to them, we explain all of this. That please understand, this is how it works. Sometimes it just happens, I begin talking to somebody 6 months ago. And in those 6 months, so obviously this particular year has seen tremendous drop in module prices internationally, right? So then they say, oh, you quoted me that price, but now I've talked to three more people and the price is 10% lower. I said that it was a different scenario then, and if it's a different scenario now. We have clients, so we explain that to them. Then we have clients where we've got repeat business. Say for Yamaha, we did a certain plant 2 years ago and we're doing a plant today. Obviously the costing has changed. It's also about how well you educate them. Having said that, if somebody wants to just be bullheaded about it and saying, no, let's renegotiate, it's difficult because that's why the explanation is there. What I've already set up, I've spent that amount of money, that's what I need to recover. It's not even like, I've paid 30% upfront and then I'm paying 30% in the next year. I'm not paying off that asset. I've bought that asset and then installed it. And that's what we try and explain to them, which is also why these 3 year and 5 year contracts do not work. Because if you tell me after 3 years, a lot of what I've used will go waste. Modules may develop micro cracks. The warranty will get voided if I'm shifting it from A to B place. Other than modules and inverters, I pretty much will have to junk everything else on that site. So relocation is possible, not ideal. All of these factors we take into account.
All right, so yeah, I mean, maybe one comment, which is why sometimes the question comes up and it in such forums that, oh, you guys only focus on the big names and you don't focus on, that's the answer. So, it is very difficult for us to do so. With that, I think we'll conclude the session. Please, yeah.
I just want to enlighten the audience here. Being a background like from the module manufacturing.
Yeah, sir, please share your.
I just want to share one thing that, when we are talking about the module prices, everybody says it has come down drastically. Nowadays, the situation is if you import modules from, particularly from China, then you may get a module at 30, 31, 32 cents, depending on the brand and quality. But when it comes to Indian module, the prices have not come down because the Indian manufacturers are still importing solar cells at a higher cost. There is a differentiation in module price and cell price in China. If you go to Chinese supplier for the cells only, then those cells are available nowadays, it is 20, 22 cents. And if you import modules, then yes, you may get module at 31, 32 cents with the good quality cell. So basically, this is what the, when you go talk about the Indian module, then yes, still it is at, in terms of rupees, it is anything from 23 to 25 rupees range right now.
Sure, sir. Just share your name and affiliation.
My name is Chetan Shah from Goldie Green.
Sir, may I give one of the gentlemen here a chance?
Hi, I'm Ravi. I've been reading for the last 2 weeks. I think it's almost, it's been very negative reports in the media on the residential rooftop solar. But whereas when I hear yourself and all of you, it sounds really bullish. I think you guys need to work on the media as well to write positive things on the rooftops, which is really required in India on the residential rooftop. Maybe Kartikeya, you can share your views on this. You need to change the perception on the media. You need to educate the media because a lot of rubbish has been written upon it. Thank you,
sir. Good point. That's it.
you can take the last comment.
Yeah, last comment. Because this is only, all the rooftop players are here. Scalability part, which I used to address. See, the state signed tripartite for.
Sir, the mic.
Tripartite for mobile. I'm looking at rooftop scalability because you're addressing only certain segment. To make it larger and the size to grow faster. So what you need to do is there are three-party agreement to sign for open access. And if the state government, one state government at least, agrees to penalize the defaulter by cutting his electricity connection, you have the payment going, which is possible. You will have to make this happen in one state, then the rest of the states will adopt herd mentality. Then you can even go to the smaller place and happily go and install rooftop. This has been, I used to do this, now I'm not addressing rooftop for maybe 4 or 5 years. One state government came close to accepting this, this you can do it, not the other one. If that happens as a policy framework or as part of the tripartite agreement, if there is a payment default, see if the payment default to the electricity department DISCOM, they disconnect. The same thing should happen here, that behavior will have to replicate it. Please work on it. We have the game going.
Yes, yeah, so we can take it offline, but from what some of us understand, it may have some, I mean, it may not be per electricity code or per the law. That's our understanding, but let's take this offline.
Yeah. All right, sir. Thank you very much. So discussing various opportunities and challenges in decentralized solar and especially about residential rooftops. So, you know, the starting of the conference, I kind of coined a theme that let's not aim just for 100 gigawatts of solar or 160 gigawatts of renewable energy capacity. Let's aim for 100% renewable energy. So then all this confusion of surplus power and all these things would go away. And clearly, like, you know, recently Mr. Modi, also our Prime Minister, mentioned that we are talking of developing like model solar cities, 100% solar powered cities. And electric vehicles, energy storage is the future. And by 2030, I think government has set a mission. So I think charity begins at home. And we as kind of front runners in this new energy game should also try and power our own buildings and offices to start with, to give the message in the society. So anyone here who has their own house or building or residential area solar powered can raise their hands. So okay, I see 2-3 hands. So I'm the fourth one. So yeah, 5-6 people. So, you know, we are a room full of people who are in the solar business. So definitely you know, moving ahead on this path of 100% renewable energy, let's go solar first, and then automatically the message will pass on to our neighbors and to our known people, and this would spread like fire, I'm sure. Thank you very much, Dr. Anurath, and the session for an amazing discussion on rooftop and decentralized solar. Big round of applause. May I kindly request Dr. Anurath to present, gives our appreciation and mementos to all the session members.